to vote Nottingham. We're in the 21st century. It's shocking that we need food banks, as again, a worthy cause to support. So Town Council raised money at coffee mornings so far, and at Village Ventures events for donations for teas and coffees. And I'd like to invite Stanley here this evening to accept a cheque from Kevin, and to include Ray in this as well, who's supported all these events.
On behalf of Stapleford Town Council and all the residents that donated, here's the money for your
Thank you so much.
Can we have a picture with Margaret on as well? Yeah. Because Margaret has been sole contributor to this. Yeah.
And another. Entertainment from 4 o'clock in the afternoon, Saturday afternoon, 4 o'clock in the afternoon till 9 o'clock at night. And the entertainment is provided by a group called the Foot Tappers. And the food is an enormous paella which is about in a dish about as wide as this table, you know, which is being made by the owner, Neil Kelso. And for the ticket prices are £18, and for that you get paella, you get a drink, you get entertainment, and all the social activities surrounding it all. And it actually happens to be Neil Kelso's birthday on that day, so he doesn't know this, but we're going to make a big cake for him, and make it really special. Right? But there are only 60 tickets, because it's out of town sign. So I would encourage you to think about coming to that as well. Thank you for the
invitation
to turn
mayor to attend. Yeah.
I
don't like
it.
Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you.
Thank
you.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank
you. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank
you. I've got my
insurance
here.
You sorted.
You okay?
two documents that we've consulted the town council over. One is the Greenbelt review as part of the preferred approach to site allocations. The other one is a discussion on potential development management policy. I'll start on the Greenbelt, and the precursor to this is the approach set out in the core strategy that I just mentioned to some of your councillors, has very recently won an award, I am pleased to say, for the East Midlands Plan of the Year. These are awards that are given by the relevant planning institute that looks at different entries. And that award was given specifically on the joint working that was undertaken between the councils, but also involving a number of discussions and liaisons with different political groups, the town and parish councils, and so on and so forth. So that I think is a piece of good news. But in terms of the implication of that plan as a whole, it does a number of things. One of them is to set the housing provision for Broxton. Another thing is to set the broad policy process for reviewing the Greenbelt. The documents that you have in front of you is the initial stage of the outcome of that review process. And what you have in detail with the main documents is a number of sort of scores and reviews for the various zones. And that is summarised in the much briefer pamphlet that I've handed out. Now, I'll deal very briefly with some of the earlier ones because they won't directly affect you in Stapleford. But the initial page is in alphabetical order, relating to Walsworth and Brinsley and Eastwood and Kimberley. And the shaded areas indicate the areas that are put forward as part of this consultation as areas that we're seeking views on removing those from the Greenbelt. I should stress the important point of principle that does not mean that these areas are allocated for development. What it means is that we think that there are sensible long-term Greenbelt boundaries that can be applied that will stop the situation of having pressure to release a little bit more and then a little bit more and then a little bit more in the future. So that's what we're keen to avoid. On the second to last page, there is the bit that will be of most interest to Stapleford members, which is the Brancott and Stapleford plan. And what that shows, you'll recognise the railway line north of the town, the white area that segregates those two shaded parts, that is the allocation of Field Farm that is already made in the core strategy. That has already been dealt with. So what we are seeking views on is taking the railway line as the long-term defensible Greenbelt boundary as we see it, and then within those shaded areas, there is the potential for residential and other allocations to be made. The pie chart on the bottom right-hand side, that shows the area based on existing information in terms of the availability of urban housing sites, how much of that area would be needed for a residential allocation or allocations. And you can see that in this area it's 9% of that land. So, slightly under 1/10 would be required. In some of the commentary in the more detailed section of the document, we as planning officers think that there are two areas within this that may be suitable. One is to the east of Field Farm, the west of Coventry Lane, the rear of the crematorium, north of Stapleford Hill and south of the railway line, that one area. Another area is on the Brancott School's site. Some of you may recall that there was some information that the school publicised about 8 months ago, saying they were seeking funding to get a redevelopment of their school. Part of that funding playing fields at the fronting onto the A52, subject to suitable facilities being provided elsewhere. We think within that area, those are locations that are worthy of some further consideration. The final one, that again we'll be familiar with, is Toton. That is dealt with in part in the core strategy. There are certain minimum development parameters that are specified in the core strategy. One of them that's most significant here is a minimum of 500 homes. The area involved will very comfortably accommodate those 500 homes. Again, the same principle is there in that pie chart, and it shows that 14% of that area would be needed. The remainder could be given over to areas of open space, school expansion land, a small local centre, extended footpaths and bridleways, and certainly employment land as well. So that sort of allows sufficient space for all of those potential uses. And in the main consultation document, there are some more detailed plans suggesting some ways in which that may take shape. And we're seeking views on that. The other part of the consultation, albeit less controversial and probably leading to less comment, is the review of development management policies. Now, one of the functions that councils need to do is to update its local plan. Part of that is done through the core strategy. The second part of it will be the more detailed site allocations and the more specific policies. And what we have done in there is given a number of broad and general comments on existing local plan policies. We've asked for what we think are working and what we think perhaps are not. The areas that we're particularly seeking views on is there is an amended suggestion in terms of our approach to flood risk, and that is to take into account the most recent flood defences. That's a decision that Councillor Grindell and others will be aware of, the Development Control Committee came to a couple of months ago. We're looking at updating the position in terms of expectations and asks in terms of affordable housing and whether there are variations that could be made of different areas in the borough. And we're also looking at the whole range of policies, but also seeing if there are specific types of allocations or policies that should be encouraged, such as accommodation to elderly members of the community. There's certainly a need for what's commonly referred to as extra care housing. We're looking to develop policies and look for locations as to where that may sensibly be located. And a whole number of other things as well, I've given sort of a brief overview of what I think may be the areas that may be of most interest to yourselves and to others. But if any of you do have any questions, then I'm very happy to answer them.
Yeah.
I've got three main questions. Apart from that, I'm very concerned this hasn't been given a lot of publicity. I haven't been on your website, anything else. Very much generally. I'm also very concerned. It sort of says this is Greenbelt boundary change, but all there is in your document is a vast amount of information, but nothing actually saying where you're thinking of changing it. I think the average member of the public, I've been through all this and gone through it, and I'm not quite clear what you're actually recommending or where you're thinking of changing anything. I think to ask anyone, even me, who is experienced in planning and looking at things, to ask them what this is about as regards what you're recommending as Greenbelt, I'm very concerned about, because I am not clear, apart from the fact this may be this site, 31 may be suitable and this may be suitable. There is nothing here that clearly states what changes you are making to the Greenbelt. Now, okay, you may be saying that you've got try and ask for people's information on that. But as it says, publication of Part 2 local plan autumn 2015, if everybody sent in all this past month stuff, I cannot see that any way you could do that by the autumn from the 23rd of March. And therefore, surely if you're asking a consultation about the Greenbelt, you should be asking, this is what we are thinking of changing. There is nothing clear in this document what you are thinking of changing at all. That's one of my notes. So what are you thinking of changing? Because you're not going to tell me you've compiled all this document without some ideas as to which areas you wish to change. Yet there's nothing in there that is telling the public what you're thinking of changing. It's just a vast amount of information with no clear indication of what you're actually asking the public. Equally, you said there a consultation, and for every area, albeit how many there are, you want a separate document, say deep, and build in. Oh, I'm sorry, I've looked at things here, I'm going to want to reply to about 10 or 12 of these at least. Trying to send 10 or 12, fill in 10 or 12 things online. I don't think that's a fair consultation. I've got a couple of other questions I'd like to ask as well, but really, it's the usual proper non-consultation, and you're not actually asking any proper questions as to what you're doing. I'm sure you have, as planners, a good idea what Green Belt is going to change, but there is nothing here saying these are the areas we're going to change or we think have changed. Next to nothing. So you're asking the public to open the question, which they can't reply to. Sorry if you're going on.
No, okay. So
I've got a couple of other questions.
I think in summary then, what changes are Broxton thinking about?
Yeah, the changes are the ones that are summarised on that sheet that has been circulated. Those changes are in the document. They are in different states, they are in different places in the document. And the reason for the order in the main document is it's very simple terms, it's done alphabetically. Borswick is first, Brinsley is second, Eastwood is third. I do take that point, but in terms of the actual proposed boundary changes, those are the ones that I have talked through. And certainly the intention is that is made clear in the document. The balance that we do need to strike, to answer your point, the balance that we need to strike is that this is the first stage of consultation on this issue. The actual process of changing the Greenbelt boundary will only be done when it has been endorsed by the local plan examining inspector with the same principle as the core strategy. So we seek views on the proposals here initially. We will then look at those views, and it may be the case that further changes and amendments are made. But the Greenbelt boundary changes that we are consulting on in relation to Stapleford and to Bramble relate to the railway line to the north of the town, and in relation to Toton, with part of it certainly in Stapleford Ward, there is the map that is on the final part of your publicity material. Those black shaded areas, those are the areas that we are consulting on amending Greenbelt boundary changes.
And so, Chairman, just a point of clarification, we used to look at me and which we've been at before. The parish boundaries are slightly different from the boundaries of the town. So part of what the area of Toton does not fall in within the boundaries of the parish of the town council, but it is part of the boundaries of the town. That's just for clarification.
Very confusing, but that's absolutely right. Yes.
Yes.
I think what Councillor Kirsty is talking about, we know obviously all sites you've highlighted. Is there a priority given to some sites over other sites? Or are you just looking for the least passage of resistance for want of a better phrase?
What we are looking at results of that appraisal are that the sites that you have summarised there, that's available on the council's website and in the various offices and so on, those are the areas, not in terms of a priority of one over another, those six separate areas, Horsford, Brinsley, Eastwood, Kimberley, and then the one at Bramford, Stapleford, and the one at Toton. Those are the six areas that we are proposing for this consultation to amend the boundaries at. It is not the case that we are saying one of those is more or less important than the other. What we are saying is that taking the borough as a whole, those are the areas that we say as planners are the least harmful to allow development to take place within, and those are the views that we're seeking for the people and the parishes and the town councils to comment on.
Firstly, then I go back to you, Dave. Can you stand that you hand it? Have your hands up? Okay, so we're doing it. Jackie, Dave.
Okay. Mine is really just a comment, if I may. Mm-hmm. Would it be acceptable for Margaret to minute the debate that we have here, because different councillors may have different views. I don't think we're going to reach a consensus. Therefore, if Margaret minutes the debate and sends that in as the town council's response to the consultation, is that acceptable?
That would be absolutely fine.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Just
in
yeah.
Chairman, isn't the consultation of Margaret's line correct? None of us have written the law minute and send that in. So everyone, or anyone who wishes to take a comment, if you make a comment, I will note it and I will note your name and it will be copied.
Because we're not going to reach a consensus.
Mr. Chairman, it's very difficult to reach a consensus around things such as this, particularly this something age of the administration.
Okay, I come to
Daniel. Everything's that Stephen's said, absolutely fine. But I mean, all it says is, there are two sites within this location that may be suitable. This isn't suggesting, it's not stating clearly, these are the ones that we're going to think of changing. It isn't clear. I can understand what I mean. I know the star and everything about it. But the average person isn't going to realise what it states here, what it is about.
We take the point, Nate, it's not specific. You understand?
I'm just wondering.
Your next point?
I just have two quick questions.
Uh-huh.
In terms of these recommendations about it, I know with the core strategy, so what time scale are we looking at? Is this for a 5-year recommendation or 15 years or 10 years?
For the plan that we're considering on now, it would match up to the timetable in the core strategy, so it's the second part of the core strategy, so to 2028.
So that's up to 2028 or 15
years.
I'm not sure about the other question, but
okay.
I mean,
what are you thinking about this?
Yeah,
to stand next, please, then John.
Yes. I think I understand that planners and planning inspectors like to have green belt boundaries that are clear and hard and easily defendable. And I can understand why. To have to help follow the railway line, because that's a clearly defendable boundary. But what I don't completely understand is why it's felt necessary to do another review of Greenbelt boundaries at this stage, because I think I'm right in saying that most people who've been following the core strategy process that assume that once the core strategy in place, but that was it. And I think a lot of people find it disturbing.
earth at Roxall playing up. So I must be repeating what I heard you just say. So some kind of explanation, Stephen, of that would be really useful.
Okay, thank you. And what this situation is that the planning process as we are undertaking it in Broxall is in two parts. The core strategy is the first part and this is the second part. The core strategy sets the housing numbers. This second part now sets out where specifically they are going to go. So what the situation with the core strategy always was, and this was perhaps the most controversial aspect of it, the various objectors were saying and criticising that we are adopting a housing figure in the knowledge that we need to make greenbelt boundary changes to meet that without showing specifically where they are, other than Field Farm. Now that is the nature of the two-part plan process. But in answer to Stan's question, is that it always was intended to do this work that we are now doing. There is a policy in the core strategy that explains the methods that we will undertake to review those boundaries. And a very important part of it is to only use the green belt where there are insufficient urban sites to provide the necessary housing. So what we have here, and this is in part in answer to the points made earlier, that these areas for consultation, it may well be that when the plan is finalised, there are smaller areas that are removed from the green belt. What we're looking to get views on here is, firstly, whether these broad areas are correct, but also whether there are smaller areas within there where we can eventually make the more detailed allocations. It is, unfortunately, the nature of things when we do them in stages, that the situation after the first stage is incomplete. That is the position we're in. What we're now looking to do is to get the complete local plan coverage, and included in that is the allocations, potentially, as you see, for the consultation there.
Okay. So is there anything else we're going to get surprised with? Is the question probably? I suppose what I'm saying is, I don't know what I don't know.
Yeah.
So what else is coming that we don't know?
What you have in front of you here, this is more than the minimum land that is needed to meet the county of Broxall Joint Council's responsibilities in terms of site allocations. So, unfortunately, I can't guarantee you that there will be no changes in the future, because there will be some people who will respond to us to say, we've got it right, and there will be numerous others responding to us to say, we've got it wrong, and then we need to look at those and to come to a view, as we did do in principle through the core strategy, to see whether we agree with some of those comments. So what is in front of us, what is in front of you here, is what we see comments on at this stage. And it is intended to pave the way here for the next stage of formal consultation, being a very much a advanced, if not a final, draft of the second part of the plan. So that's what we're looking to move on with after the local and national elections in May.
Can I just clarify for the minutes so that I'm taking this going correctly? This is the first part of a longer consultation process that has been, and you're asking this council to comment on it. And then people have heard me say this before, this council has been at the end of its administration. Right. So we have agreed that the minutes from this meeting will go ahead as comments from this administration. So
this will be one of many consultations and debates that we'll have around this table. Right, okay, I've got John next, then I've got David back.
Thank you, Mr. Mayor. This has been going on now about 8 years almost for Saturday holiday day. And when I first saw it, I asked one question. I said, is it going to hell? Where's the next one going to go and when? That's been answered. After 2020, there will be another castle in here saying, talking the same thing we're talking now, expanding furthermore and agricultural level. So I recognise the word rebalancing. I take the view of 1945 when it was proposed changes at a cultural level from the Bebop, and that's a fact of history, I don't know if that's a quote a fact of history. But because of reconstruction, all that was pushed on the side. Now, we are encroaching more and more into Stapleford, what's left of that group, is very small, and not expecting consistency at all. So my overview is simple. In 2028, will there be anything left? Will be one mega city. Now, in my opinion, the Green Belt or Agricultural Review is going to come out of the course strategy, as mentioned at the time. What their rate come from is coming from there. Personally speaking, I'm totally opposed to it. You know, I support it in a very shape or form at this stage of development. I think it's very, very dangerous.
Can you just clarify for me?
I'm actually opposed to Green Bond Review.
You're opposed
to the Green Bond Review? Yes. Okay. I've changed agriculture about the decision to the EU.
Yeah. All right, thanks for your point, John. Yeah, we appreciate that. We can't worry about what's going to happen in 2028.
Well,
that's for somebody else to deal with.
Well,
deal with this one.
Yeah, I totally disagree.
Okay, thank you. David?
Firstly, regards to core strategy and its minimum, we all know, having read the core strategy, that it actually states a minimum of that amount. That means that we don't have to achieve that. It means if developers wish to choose green belt, they can quite happily take more than that. This is a minimum requirement. So therefore, this is an open ball game. It isn't a case of saying, well, we need this amount of houses or this amount of land. It means we need this minimum amount. So that's one point I'd like to make. The other thing that very concerns me is this wonderful point scale, where there's the very thing at the bottom. It says, assist in urban regeneration. No staff bother to be awarded because every single site is said, is considered that all sites in the Greenbelt assist in urban regeneration. This is not considered to be a matter of difference between the Greenbelt, and therefore none of this is scored. Now surely some of those sites ought to have some score, or does that mean that thank you very much, Rutland is quite happy to take any single one of them? As why? Because they're not prepared to give them one priority or not. So that's my other concern about that, and I really do feel concerned about that. The other thing I'm concerned about is we're looking at all this green belt in the local development scheme. Okay, I was at the core strategy maker, so I will make a good decision again. I see nothing to show that Rochdale is looking extensively for brownfield sites. There are plenty of brownfield sites still. I don't see that they're actually making that. And I think that is disgraceful that they're not making that effort. All they're looking about is Greenbelt County. And that is all that is being considered, how much Greenbelt land they can build on. So, just a final one little question. If a developer submits plans for any single one of these areas, would Rochdale Borough Planners discourage them or would they encourage them? Any one of these sites, would they say, well, this scores 15 points and therefore we'd rather not do it? Or this scores 8, wonderful. Or do they really not care? If a developer came along and said, I want to build on this, are you going to turn around and say, well, we think this is wonderful, Greenbelt, it's 15 points? Or are you going
time, yes. And the reason that, that we would do that is because what we are looking to do as part of this work is to decide where the greenbelt boundaries should be changed. That these sites remain in the greenbelt at the current time. And as I mentioned before, there is quite deliberately more land included in the consultation as the minimum requirement. Your other points in terms of the housing figures, that is, you're right, that's a minimum figure, but it is very much encouraged, it's very much required that the urban sites are looked at and developed as a very, very significant and the primary part of that overall package. Because in terms of the comments regarding nothing about brownfield, well, there have been a number of large applications that have very recently been supported at Boots and Eastern Business Park, at Kimberley Brewery, and various other locations as well, as Councillor Grinnell and others are aware of. And so the issue, sorry, the final point that you mentioned in terms of urban regeneration, the point we made there is not that the sites don't matter, but the purpose of having land in the green belt is exactly so that the developers are encouraged, if not required, to build in existing urban areas, hence assisting with urban regeneration. So the point we make there is not that the green belt site can be built on to help with urban regeneration, it's saying that the site as in its current form in the greenbelt means that the developers are encouraged to build in the existing built-up area. So that's the reason we say that all of them form that function. And just very, very briefly, sorry, in the final point, is that this is a shared approach between four councils. So there is agreement across the wider area, and this is the very least the way to assess these proposals.
Stephen says about you encourage urban regeneration. Everybody around this table knows it's much cheaper to build on greenfield than brownfield. So I'm sorry, there are no financial incentives to that. So greenfield is far cheaper. And every developer in this country, having been to the core strategy and listened to the developers, every single one of them would much rather build on greenfield than on urban regeneration. So, fine, you may encourage it, but there is no incentive for any builder to do it. He'd much rather build on the greenfield, by far. As regards to being all the other councils, well, I'm sure they've all got their other agendas. I think we won't go into what separates the greenfield. I'm sure we all know what their agenda of the city council is wanting to take over the area. So, you know more, I don't want to say any more. I shall send my own comments.
Okay.
Can I say thank you for explaining the reason for this new review of sports. There is a feeling out there that it shouldn't be happening. Donnie made it very clear that it was always intended to happen. It was actually in the existing full strategy process. But let me say one or two other things in response to the particular proposals. And the first one is a question. My question is, why is it felt necessary to include Bradford Hills Park to exclude that from the Greenbelt? I'm absolutely sure that there's absolutely no intention to release Bradford Hills Park from the building. I'm absolutely sure of that. I'm not in the right mind. Around building on the green flag side. But if it's not in the green belt, it might actually increase its vulnerability to developers. As David said, coming along, so it's a beautiful plan.
Yeah.
Wouldn't it be nice to have houses in the middle of the
road?
So I'm not quite sure why it's not necessary to do that. And secondly, I have looked at these plans, and if you take the two areas that have been discussed tonight, and then the sort of Tolton area. If those areas are taken out of the back of the greenbelt, what it actually leaves is a piece of old
it's the line to the left-hand side of the road, which is going towards the Derby. It leaves a piece of open land which is still in green belt, but actually isn't attached to any external green belt. It also is kind of enclosed. And my feeling is that if these particular plans go through, and then you're left with this sort of boundary sort of green belt, that would make that even very vulnerable as well, because any planning inspector might in the future might not see that spot where the person agreed about it, but it's not the green to all the other green developers around Derby and so on. So I just want to express those concerns, A, is it really necessary to take traffic for the most part out of the equation? I absolutely agree with that. And B, is it really necessary to come to a structure which actually really takes a green belt away from the rest of the green belt, and therefore, in my opinion, makes it more vulnerable?
Yeah. I'm agreeing, yes, okay. Nobody starts talking about
that. I think we all agree on that.
In terms of the point that you made, Councillor, vis-a-vis Bramkett Hills Park, there were some comments made earlier, I think by you, but it was relating to the issue of long-term defensible boundaries. That is one of the things we need to look at. What our comments are, what our statement is here, is that the railway line is one such long-term defensible boundary. What we then do not, it does not follow, that all of the lands to the south of that will be developed. But the difficulty we have, you're absolutely right, inspectors do like long-term defensible boundaries, as do planning officers. And the reason is that it's a very, very clear line on the ground that shows where that boundary is. The absence of that means that there is constant pressure to take a bit more, to take a bit more, to take a bit more. And we are seeking to have a long-term view that will deal with the situation in the future. I can reassure you that there is no intention from anybody to build houses on Bramkett Park. That is not the idea. But if there is any release of land at all in this location, then the second point you make, which is also a very good one, that would apply even more so here, because when we're sort of talking about the potential for taking some land and taking some land at Bramkett Stapleford, and the area in between doesn't really perform a greenbelt function. Again, that's a perfectly valid point to raise, but in response I would simply say that the principle of development at Totem was dealt with through the core strategy. We're now looking at the detail of where the boundaries should be. So that decision in principle has already been taken, because it's at that end that there's the greater enclosure. And I would also add that when one of your other colleagues was mentioning when the green belt was originally drawn on the 1940s, 1950s time, it was a much, much less densely populated area at that time. What we have now is Long Eaton further to the west. And of course there were houses there at that time, but it has been built up over the years, the same as other places have as well. So what we have now is that Long Eaton is already a hard stop, if you like, between the western edge of Greater Nottingham and Derby. So to that extent, the land in this area is already enclosed to a certain extent in greenbelt ground. But the example of Bramkett, if for the sake of argument, we kept Bramkett Hills Park in, kept Stapleford Hill in, kept Pit Lane Recreation Ground, then we're not left with a long-term defensible boundary to define those areas as opposed to the rest. And what we can and what we will do is, if the Greenbelt boundaries are changed in this regard, what we would then be able to do is identify certain areas for building within them, but certain areas for absolutely not building on, and having other environmental and protection designations in there. So that's the sort of thinking behind it. And it is the case that the greenbelt boundaries are important, but it doesn't indicate everything would be built on. That's not the idea.
Thank you very much. Richard, if you've got a question or comment?
I mean, you just said, like, if you release all this brownfield there, there could be little bits that's picked on to be built on. It's going to be field farm again. There's 450 acres going on field farm. We've lost loads of it already. And now, it just looks like we're going after the rest of the field farm to build on. It's just ridiculous.
Yeah.
And it just shouldn't be in there. It's all part of this wildlife corridor that goes through Brampton, through the golf course, all the way out to the city.
Yeah.
And we need to protect all of it, not just little bits, but the whole wildlife corridor all the way through, and release it from the green belt. It's just wrong.
I agree.
Thank you for that. John?
Just a quick one, because I mean, this probably not be dealt with it all our lifetimes anyway. But just another one is, what does concern me, seeming to stand a number of people, right, is them, what about Stephen defending corridors here, there and everywhere, but the most obvious corridor that you're saying could be defended or won't be defended is probably from Sicily Avenue up towards the cemetery, which goes on to Bull Lane, which if you look at the map, is quite a good area for development and for developers. So, are we going to try and defend places like that, or are we just going to say, well, it's all right, we'll build there? Because that concerns me, because if you look at it, that goes up along the A52 corridor.
Yeah.
Are we saying that's a boundary or not? I don't know. I mean, I get confused sometimes when people talk, but that will increase Stapleford conurbation, as you all say. And that's an ideal place, in my eyes, being honest, for people to develop, which is connecting Sicily to Bull Lane. Mm-hmm. So are we going to defend places like that, or are we just going to say, yeah, it's all right? I don't know, Stephen. I mean, I'm confused, but it's just a question.
And, yeah, the probably Sicily Avenue area that part of this consultation is proposed to remain in the Greenbelt, same as it is at the moment. So the answer is yes, that would be unchanged as Greenbelt.
Do we have any other comments or questions?
I think we should say thank you.
Yes. Yeah, well, that's fine.
I'd love to do that as well, so thank you. Sorry for my questions, as usual. I'm sure you expected it from me. The other thing I'd like to say is that, please, there's an awful lot here that we really can't discuss. We can't make any decisions. Please, councillor, anybody else who's got strong feelings on, please, write it yourself.
Uh-huh.
Don't just depend on this council and the council peer doing. Make your own comments. It is up to you to make your own comments, and to include anybody who's not strong speaking about it, or people who aren't even aware of it, to do that and make sure that they get the impact back across them. And of course, Stephen would appreciate it. So, even if it might be stroppy, whatever, but you want the feedback. So, please encourage everybody to do it yourself.
I've got one more point of concern there. The rise of the Green Communities, Stephen, mentioned the fact that the poor strategy in our area had actually received an award from the East Midlands Royal Town and Planning Institute as a ceremony last night. Now, we may all have different opinions on what we think about the poor strategy. What we hope and expect is that those people who are working on it do what they do to the very best of their professional ability.
Yes.
And I just want to point out that they have won this award.
Mm.
And I'm
Thank you very much, Stephen, on behalf of the Stapleford Town Council. It's quite an emotive subject for us as we live here, it's right on our doorstep. And again, as Dave said, you have 3 weeks Monday to make your complaints, comments, feedback, whatever you want to call them. As I said, it's quite emotive. Please do it, and we look forward to the next round.
Mr. Chairman, I will do a full minute reference for this item. I will take on board your comments that have been expressed during the table this evening. I would do members wish to make a few comments. Just remind you, you're not making a mistake for Town Council. You're making it with individuals. And please bear in mind what you say. If you think you may become a councillor again, be re-elected, or whatever, that you will be making comments and you will see this consultation.
Make sure that it's an individual without mentioning the council.
Yes, that's why I'm saying make sure to do it as an individual.
Okay then, let's come back to the agenda. And we're going to come back to item 3, the Town Council meeting held on the 16th of January.
Have to propose
those. Okay. Can I have all those in favour?
Thank you.
Any against? Okay, carried, thank you. Moving on then to the family environment.
Thank you for noting, Mr. Chairman. However, I understand that I transpose Councillor Pearson as Councillor Grass, and I do apologise for that. I will change it for this plan.
I thought you were twins.
Good God, I hope not.
Why are we all the same?
Okay then. Moving on then, item 5, any requests from a member of the public to address the Town
Council? I have no request.
Okay. Thank you very much. Mayor's engagements?
Yes, Mr. Chairman. I live on Bank, etc. Every time he speaks there, and we had a wonderful time last night at Dublin Christ Church for the last Little Adventures event of the year. It was very, very wonderful, and something I should point out, I think, just like anything, the number of people who attend these events who are on their own. But at times, I know there's a lot of work going on for loneliness and places where people can go, particularly for the older ladies. It is somewhere people can go and the youth people, and it's a very nice event. So we raise money from the lots of charities we always do. Fabulous event. The dancing at the hotel earlier, I know it was the deputy mayor and the mayor of Rockford were at that event, and it was brilliant.
It was absolutely
fabulous event again. Can I help my team to get me all these events and do? I think my son James Lafferty for his front of house help, which particularly the music event was fabulous. And my poor husband and James again last night, who found themselves moving furniture and very heavy screens at the end of the night. I thank them for that. I will be bidding again in the new year. These events are very popular. I've been working with Anne at Roxburgh Council on a strategy document which supplies him with a lot of information with regards to village ventures. So I'd just like to say, please to look at posters outside and see some of the things that put on over the years. Civic service, again, clapped by my team, again, for the support. It was a lovely event, the Salvation Army for their hospitality and the warmth of their friendship. Thank you very much for that.
Can we actually send our thanks to the
church? I have come to them personally.
We have done an invitation, has been said, so to thank them for the events again. I don't know what's going to happen to civic service in the future, and I will bring that to the first proper business meeting in the administration. There's all kinds of events took place, there's lots of pictures outside, lots of things still coming up.
Yeah, even just make a point. I was at Rockwell Court with some of the residents when they had their belated Christmas party. And yeah, Rockwell Rocks. Speaking to the warden there, Mary, she was saying that she will invite more councillors along. She will send an open invitation to the Town Council. It was great to sit there with some of the people just to listen to some of their memories of how Stapleford are. Most of them actually have lived in and around Stapleford all their lives, so it was great to talk to them. And they're full of fun. And they would like us to go along. So there will be an open, open meeting. Some of the residents are actually planning their own events now. Elizabeth and her husband starting to get more going and coordinate a lot more events. And they, like I said, they will be inviting us councillors along. So please encourage you to go along. Great.
You said there's some more events coming up. If you've got any leaflets in that, we've got a new notice board up on the estate, so people there probably like to come to the house, so more that for them for you.
Absolutely. Yeah, thank you for the offer there. Okay. That's great.
I'm just chairman, I have it out and receiving a key for that notice board imminently. I will obviously take out some material will be posted in it. With regards to what I'm talking about, I think it should be thank you to Sunit and my friend who are the volunteers who run the coffee morning to raise the money for the residents to hold these events. And she's there taking pictures as well and showing up on Wednesday night. It was an excellent night, and I think something carries the borough were delighted that the town council was supporting it. Can we see a lot of events coming up, I said. Can I just draw your attention to the Easter Bonnet Coffee Morning, which again is for the Mayor of Rochester's charity, which is in the new financial year. So there's only a few more things coming your way for that one. So, and an invitation that I can send to Sam. So I'm going to see you in your Easter Bonnet. Right, now, there's something else I need to say. I need to apologise to the town mayor. I understood that the town mayor had been invited to Stapleford Job Fair on Wednesday the 11th of March, and I prepared my little engagement by agenda and it was posted out. And I thought it was an excellent for the town mayor to attend this event given his professional career and working life. However, after I had of course sent out the agenda, I received an email telling me that the town mayor had been uninvited. So I do apologise for the town mayor, and I apologise to town council for receiving erroneous information.
Yeah, you just mentioned about the notice boards. I don't know why you're getting a key for that, because the notice board is something that Roxborough Council puts up. It took my community 2 years working with them to get the notice board up. And with this, like a little, if you call it a constitution or something, that Roxborough Council have agreed to. And anybody wanting to put anything on the notice board, there's an address to post it to. It's on the notice board, because we didn't want too many people putting stuff up, putting stuff down. Everything that goes on there gets a date on it, and it goes on for 3 weeks, or obviously if it's something comes up. It's not a political notice board, and it's purely for information, so people in Stapleford North, which is a deprived area, know what's happening in other areas. And I think it's quite sad that people have been complaining about the notice board and bringing up the council, trying to cause trouble, which I was made aware of, but that was ridiculous.
Mr. Chairman, can I just come in? I don't know anything that's in the background. I've just received an email from Dr. Burgess regarding this matter. It arrived this afternoon. I was working last night. Obviously afternoon last night, and I was here catching up, but I hadn't been in the office. I haven't dealt with anything other than urgent emails today from my email account. I will be looking at emails on Wednesday because I'm on leave on Tuesday. I'll deal with it on Wednesday. If you wish to come in and see me, maybe
I can bring you the thing down.
See me after the meeting, Richard.
Yeah, of course. Come
in,
thank you.
Come in and see me next week. Anyone else on mayor's engagement? Just to remind you, the town mayor is in post until the next annual council meeting of the town council, which will be
really. When is the election?
Pardon?
When is the
election? Mr. Chairman, at the election, once you have lost your seat, once the count is over,
yes.
If you have not stood for election, that would be you. If you have stood for election and re-elected, you then need to come in and sign your forms. If you've stood for election and not been elected, you need to be a councillor.
There is asked a question, as we call it, because it's different for MPs.
Yes.
Because MPs, when they dissolve the parliament,
let's move on then. Allotments. I think we only have a brief update.
Mr. Chairman, I just very quick report for you. Part of the problem at the moment is changing daily as people go and hopefully developing a wildlife site. Some work needing done on that, there's some stumps that need to be ground out, some topsoil needed, some membranes needed, and that would be part of the allotment needs to fill. That would come out of allotment needs before the end of the financial year.
Moving on then, Town Centre Management Team.
Mr Mayor, at the last Town Centre Management Team, I thought it was an extremely good meeting, like the previous one. And first of all, that the Town Team are obviously looking at finances in the future, and there's a budget which is coming up, which will receive about £3,000 in April. There is always still money in the bank. We're looking at, first of all, Farmers Market, which will be on the 7th of March at Walter Park. And we hope that everyone will go down on the 7th of March and actually enjoy whatever goods there are there. And this is going to be once a month for the time. And I think it's an extremely good idea having a Farmers Market. Secondly, there is a leaflet. It's not come out yet, so it has to be changed slightly, but there is a leaflet that will go to every house in Stapleford area. At the moment, it names 132 businesses, shops and professional businesses. It's going to be slightly changed. There are quite a few emails going around from members of the group making possible changes. At the front, at the top, where you normally see Stapleford on the bags and on the pens, are looking to change that. I mean, Stapleford itself, believe it or not, at the top, it does say Stapleford. But even I can't see that. So it is going to be redesigned slightly to make it more effective. The front page of this looks very nice, but it's not, because unfortunately the flower people are right on top of the reeds, and they didn't think that was a very good idea. Thirdly, I would say that all these leaflets will be printed and will come out this year. Not quite sure when yet. As I say, the finances this year, Christmas is going to come up upon the time. There's a lot of planning to go ahead. There's a lot of things hopefully happening in Iceland's Car Park and all the way along the High Street, Derby Road. Obviously, we're hoping for a lot more entertainment before Christmas, and things going to be slightly different than last year. But this year it's been decided that in fact Christmas will start in the afternoon and not quite so early in the morning as it did last year. We felt that there was more energy needs to be put into the afternoon and the evening. There's been a business survey that's been done, and most of the businesses have been surveyed, and there's a lot of information coming, and I know it's going to be highlighted soon. I know that Councillor Jackie Witness will be attending the next one, as I'm unavailable, and I think you'll really know about that. But at the end of time, in April, when the April meeting, no councillor from this town council or anyone that's up for political reasons for election obviously cannot attend the April meeting.
Mr Chairman, for point of clarification, I understand that the Town Centre team have decided that we don't want anyone attending that meeting who will be standing for election either.
Yeah.
That's my understanding.
That is correct. It is correct as well. So that's it, and you will be receiving full minutes. Thank you.
It's £2,000 they're getting, not three. When they get the money updated, they're being told they're getting £2,000 off the council.
If I could interrupt, thank you very much for that, Councillor. Yes. If I can actually say, it was quoted at the meeting at £2,500, so I think we just have to wait.
Chairman, I'll get clarification.
Thank you very much. Right. Do you have any other questions? Sorry, John.
So I'd like to thank the Roxholme Town Centre management team, but it took them a bit. Well, Councillor McRae has been involved as well, and Councillor Darby, for sorting the planters out, repairing the town. And perhaps when we're all re-elected or whatever, Margaret, it was part of the, like, perhaps when we're all re-elected or we might not be, I'd appreciate if the town centre, well, the Stapleford Council could probably put something in as well, towards the planters through the town.
Absolutely agree.
Chairman, I need to come in here on this one. My understanding is that the town centre is going to use planters.
They've donated some money, Margaret.
Yes.
So what I'm saying, I'm thanking them, right? I'm thanking the town centre management team, the donor from Broxton Mugger, and also thank Richard's group and all that for helping us. And I'm requesting that if we're all selected or re-elected, is it possible that us as a town council could also put
in the town council?
Mr. Chairman, you can't discuss this to the council.
No, I'm just thanking people, Margaret.
No, Councillor, just clarification again. You're asking for finance to look at finance. You can't do
after
that.
The next
no,
election.
You can't do that.
That's okay, but I'm thanking people anyway.
Okay, you thank people all you like, but it's something that you can tell the council, sorry, John. But just to keep it as it should be, the if you wish to make an application for funding to the new administration, it needs to be done formally through the normal
which I will.
Process.
If elected.
You can do it even if you're not elected, councillor, but you need to do it with the new administration and not at this point. And this is why we're going to, this is the last meeting tonight, because we're starting to run into problems here. So, bear in mind for after me.
Okay, then. Do we have any kind of any other comments for the town centre management team? Okay, let's move on then. Neighbourhood plan.
I've nothing to report on this at the moment. I keep receiving documentation from Lightcrest Centre, mainly from consultants asking me to consider employing them. And by understanding, I understand that the Oxford Council will not be taking the Stapleford Park candidate until late in March, and it won't go through. So it will be after the election before anything comes through. It will be the new administration.
We actually did say at the last meeting, if I remember rightly, nothing would happen until the next election is over, until the next administration is in place, and then we'll have to take it from there, as we already said.
Okay, fine, thank you very much, Jen. Moving on, we've already had Stephen Saunders from Broxton. Moving on then, Stapleford Matters, item 11.
Yes, Mr. Chairman. Just to let you know, I have sent comments and as discussed. I understand that there are a lot of issues at the county with regard to the traffic orders. I think you possibly want to record your, if not distress, your sorrow, shall we say, that what's happened.
Okay, I've got Lee first of all, then I've got David.
Just to say that at a quarter to ten last night, County Hall, the budget was passed on the chair's casting vote. Taken 11 hours to get to that point, and that budget included not only an increase in council tax but a 44% reduction in the highways management section. And therefore, all residential parking schemes, parking restriction orders, all the various things that we have been applying for are in jeopardy, basically. So, I can't tell you whether they're going to go ahead or not.
Okay, thank you very much for that. That's a little bit concerning for us, considering we've been trying to deal with this
for years.
Yes, well, obviously that's shock news, Mr. Mayor. But we, as a council, as members of the council here, we have got to fight for what is right and for what we've been fighting for a very long time. So, obviously, I know that Councillor Heppenstall, and I know Councillor Darby here, and Councillor McGrath, and Councillor Pearson and Williams and myself and others will actually lobby the county on this, because so much work's been done. Residents have just received new letters this past week in certain streets and certain areas, telling them this, what a wonderful thing that's been achieved. We've gone as far as we can with it, as Councillor Heppenstall actually knows. So we're just going to have to wait and see, Mr. Mayor, what happens next. But I'm asking our county councillors to keep a really tight eye on this for us. Thank you.
All right, okay, thank you very much. With that in mind, Do we have any other comments around Stapleford matters? Ray, first of all?
Yeah, and there's quite a few issues. I know they're supposed to have done a lot of the lining and alterations already. Right. They sent notices out to all the constituents involved. And I should say they've only done, well, they've certainly missed three or four areas that I know. They marked them ready to, to do, and they told them they're going to cone them off, then they collected the cones and didn't do them. So I don't know how they're going to substantiate the cost in the budget, because they haven't done the actual work. So why should we be paying them if they haven't done it?
Right.
Well, we have done. Well, we've been paying them already, actually, maybe.
I can't answer that, bear in mind the budget last year was only agreed last night, that's probably the reason why it hasn't been carried on. Richard, I've got you and then I've got John afterwards.
Yeah, for some strange reason, bollards have been stuck on the corner of Moorfield Court right now.
It's not on the agenda.
Well, last time when we did this, we were talking about stuff that wasn't on the agenda because you said it was traffic and parking. That's
it,
right.
It's not,
you're talking about
specific
bollards. Okay, then, I reckon Stapleford has got bollards on the shoulder staff. Yeah. And it looks like they put them in the wrong place, and the county council went to have made a mistake. The places that need bollards on a certain street, the police and members of the community want them.
I understand that this has already been passed to the county council.
Will know that I was copied into recent emails. I knew nothing about this until we raised this issue. The explanation as to why those bollards were put in that particular place have been explained to him by the senior highways officer. That's all I can say on the matter.
Okay.
With all due respect, things to do with bollards are not the affair of this town council. Councillor McRae should be taking it up with suitable bodies. There's nothing that we, as individuals of the council, can do. Councillor McRae fully knows the thing, and he's quite capable of putting the Evening Post, so I suggest he adopts that matter of his own.
Well, you can always send a letter to complain that I put things in the Evening Post if you want, I suppose.
Mr. Chairman, please.
Let's bring it back to the agenda item, please.
So we're not allowed to talk about things as well.
Mr. Chairman, if you wish issues are on the agenda, let me know at least 10 days before so I can get them on the agenda.
Really fine,
the problem with it is.
That means it's not going to be done from this financial year.
We're the with the town clerk being instructed, as soon as she knows any correspondence from the county,
I will copy
everyone.
I've already sent the letter.
Okay, great.
Just
all right, I've got John first of all, then I've got John London, then John McGrath.
Just a quick one, which, it just shows what the county officers or people are. On Orchard Street and Pinfold Lane, I mean, I think they put traffic regulations in, and I think we're all aware that there's going to be new bills there.
Yes.
And I did speak to Officer Jackie, Stan, and he was unaware that there was going to be planning permission in for houses and everything. So I think we need to address those problems with the county and get them into action.
John, I've just been informed that Leader Ed has informed the county, so they're fully aware now. Okay, John Longley.
Yeah, just to clarify something, I believe we're going to mark, we're going to be debating on a Sunday, not in a week. So it'd be interesting if they were back down this Sunday, if I remember correctly. After this Sunday, I think I'm right.
I can see why they were doing them as well.
Yeah, so they were marked out more than to ask you the car for anything to do the work. So they've just gone away and left it. So I'll be interested this Sunday, see if I'm not. But I think I am.
Right, okay, thanks for that observation. John, do we have any other points around the statement of matters? Okay, no? Alright, let's move on then. Correspondence. We have the Steel, Friends of Steel Farm.
Obviously, am I allowed to speak then?
I thought it'd be determined.
No. What I'm saying is there's been a lot of confusion, obviously. A lot of people are stopping me in Stapleford about whether Audi's going there or not.
Well, Mr. Chairman, we can't discuss that. It's not in front of you.
Well, that's why I asked you.
I'm sorry, once Tom's come in the town council can discuss it, you can't discuss what is in front of you.
Well, that's why I asked you, Chair.
No.
The previous
application, John, that you talked about was where we discussed the 54 houses.
I know.
And there's no way to choose down to 49, I believe. But that's all that we have. That's the only information we have. Audi might not happen. We can't talk about what might not happen. Okay? Let's move down to the... let's move down to the extension to the kennels down on.
Hickman's
Lane.
But can I just say, the reason you have this in front of you is just because it says single story rear and single story front extensions. The town council has a policy here of anything that's for the front just to be brought to town council.
Sure, yeah.
I've been asked to do that. That's the only reason you've got it. As far as I'm aware, there are no objections to it, no one has brought that to me. So I'll just ask you if anyone has any comments or objections on it.
Any other comments? Yeah,
thank
you. Okay, fine, thank you very much. And now we'll come on to the kennels. again, right next to the 52 on Festival Lane, out the way. I don't really concern anybody, but that's my own personal opinion. Do we have any comments?
I think it's a good idea, because I heard from someone earlier say it's a good place to take your dogs. So.
Can I say that's not a planning consideration? Although I'm just a nervous to mayor, eh? I would have thought if they had that building I did now, I would have wanted a bigger sewage, but a smaller one.
Mr. Chairman, my understanding the kennels have acquired land for whatever they want to do with it. Now, over the years that we've had applications from the kennels as they've expanded and their business has grown, and I've always been asked again to bring it to the town council, and that is why you keep seeing the kennels come up to. I haven't, again, have no objection, no explain. It's just for your information.
Okay, then, take it there's no other points for the planning applications. Then moving on for items for future agenda, bearing in mind this is going to be our last.
Yeah, it's not here. Again, Mr. Chairman, I'm asked to keep this item on the agenda, but at this point, the light of the administration. Yeah, it's okay. Can I just say, for anyone who is standing again and will be elected, if you wish anything on the agenda, please let me know in good time so I can get it on the agenda so I can accept it and ensure that it's viable and that the information is available for members. There's nothing more politeness on the agenda than I have to sit here and say, I'm sorry, I know nothing about it. If you are the elected, please let me have things in good time.
Okay, thank you very much. Then after moving on, item 15, payments.
Mr. Mayor, as you can see in front of you, we've put out the sheets for January. Because we do not have another town council meeting, it doesn't mean to say the one is not going to keep an eye on the finance, and the finance is running extremely well. And the town clerk and Mr. Chief have done a good job, as I said, at the budget meeting. And one will be keeping an eye on it over the February, March, and April time. And I'm sure that everything will slide into place at the end of March for April.
Thank you very much.
Chairman, I will be sending
a report
to
all members
at the end of the
last week,
so they are aware of the
decision. But I do not think that there will be any problems. No. Okay, thank you very much. And obviously, as it's our last meeting, I'd like to thank Councillor David Grindell and the Finance Committee for all their hard work, to keeping us on straight and narrow. I hope and wish that the new administration adheres to the budget, because it's a sound budget, so thank you all, and also the town staff and Kim for all their hard work by keeping an eye on things. I think that's us. The date of the next meeting will be on Friday the 22nd of May here at 7:30. There will be an annual
town meeting before that, generally at 6:30, about an hour before. And I'd like to wish you all good luck in whatever, whether you're standing here or whether you're not, or whatever else you're moving on to. I know we'll see you over the next couple of months anyway.
Mr. Chairman, can I take this opportunity to thank members of the Lawsmith throughout 4 years and the nearly 20 years that I've been in post here, for those who have been here that long. For those who are retiring from council business, I wish you all the best in the future. For those who are standing, no matter what your political colours are, I wish you good luck, and I hope that you have a successful time canvassing, and it is in the lap of the gods who have elected me, who's not. I do wish everyone the best of luck for whatever they are doing in the future. Can I also say there will be no committee meeting, there will be enough there the civic event that evening, and but I will be sending out reports of what's happening before the end of the financial year.
We would like to thank the town clerk here because she's caused chaos and confusion for us, and she's done a thorough job with him. And I must admit, without a bit of Scottish satire, we wouldn't get anywhere yet. So thank you.
So,
Tim?
Well, I actually, maybe it's I did want to say to stop, to end the meeting without recognising the hard work of Margaret and Kim and all the staff have actually done. Yes. Sometimes I disagree with what we can do in meetings, what we can't do. And I know Margaret knows what we can do, what we can't do. but the care and concern and dedication demonstrated by our employees to the town and to the people of Stapleford, yes, second to none.
Absolutely.
Thank you very much.
Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Can I have
one more comment from John? I'm very strong, whatever I was going to say. I also can thank the town and the deputy mayor for their heavy time, very well, in the past 20 million, this will get all the engagements and the last few to come.
Thank you.
That's
just a quick remark, thank you for everything you've done, and by the way, get yourself a new bell, and start paying for the car park when you park it across. Thank you.